हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। सो थैंक यू प्रभु जी। द वीडियो दैट वाज बीइंग प्लेड जस्ट बिफोर दिस वाज वेरी वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड रिलेवेंट, लाइक हाउ श्रीला प्रभुपाद वाज गिविंग प्रैक्टिकल इंस्ट्रक्शंस अबाउट हाउ टू हैंडल मनी एंड व्हाट इज द प्लेस ऑफ मनी इन आवर कॉन्शियसनेस इन आवर मूवमेंट। So in that brief 3 to 4 minute video, we saw some of the principles Srila Prabhupada shared with us. For one and foremost is that money should be used for Krishna's service only. Like whatever we have got, it is for Krishna's service, and he spent the money according to priority. So he has a priority that printing books is the number one priority. So any other goals which we have, it comes after that. So it's the basis of that budgeting thing, right? So we keep whatever is needed first and spend money on that first. And then if we have surplus, then we think about doing something else, but not at the cost of doing the needful first. So that was the principle he shared in that, and which we discussed in the first session. And then he mentioned that reporter asked from where you get money, and he said God provides us, God gives us money. So that is another thing, because everything is given by Krishna. Krishna is the ultimate proprietor. We are not the proprietor, and he is controlling everything, including how much money or how much wealth we will get in our this lifetime. So that is the principle. Like, we have to understand that we are just an instrument. We do whatever is needful, whatever maybe facilities or circumstance or intelligence provided by Krishna, we will act according to it. But ultimately, he is the giver. Ultimately, he is the proprietor. So Srila Prabhupada has given all these wonderful instructions to us. So we just have to follow that. We don't have to do anything different or anything extraordinary in order to lead our life in a perfectly Krishna conscious way, even in this so-called modern material world. So with that, we'll start in today's session. So just a quick recap, like in first session, we discussed the importance of budgeting and saving and how that is very important. And then in second session, we discuss about how we can take advantage of equity investment to build a corpus over a period of time. And we see that we don't have to save or earn a lot in order to have a comfort, in order to have a corpus for retirement. And we discuss like various options which are available, like even if we do early retirement, then what options we have. And even if we take the normal retirement, then what options we have. And even at the time of retirement at the age 65, we don't have anything, then what options we have. So in either case, there should not be any anxiety as far as finances are concerned. It's just a matter of our will, that our desire and our will should be very strong, that why I want to take retirement or a vanprastha, why I want to take early or a normal age retirement, and what I'm going to do. That is more important. So money will be available in either case. It's just that if we are ready to compromise, if we are ready to make some adjustment to our lifestyles or where we want to live, how we want to live, then at any point of time, we can make that decision. And especially those of us, we are living in US and working here for 6, 7, 8, 10+ years. I don't see any reason why anybody would not be able to make that decision, because money is not a problem. It's something different which is holding us back, but definitely money is not a problem. So with that, we move on to the today's session, which is about the fear management. So like, how do we take care of fear of unknowns and all the material problems which we may get? And that is one of the primary reason which tend us to hold more and more, you know, because we don't know about the future. We are not sure what's going to happen tomorrow. And due to that uncertainty or that unknown and that fear which we have in back of our mind, we want to accumulate and accumulate and accumulate till the time of death, because we are never sure that how much I'm going to need, and if I don't have it, then what? So due to that, we get into that mentality of hoarding and hoarding, and we never seems to have enough, because no matter amount, how much we accumulate or how much we hoard, we still feel that anything can happen. So let me keep on holding, you know, keep on accumulating. So today we are going to discuss some very practical ways, very low cost practical ways to deal with all kind of such fears which can come in our material life, and how we can safeguard ourselves against those. So before that, let's first understand what actually fear is. So fear is nothing but a mental suffering of something which has not yet happened, and which we are just imagining, like our mind is just imagining. So our mind imagines some future suffering, some future situation, and because of that which we suffer in present. And that suffering which our mind is causing us in our present is called fear. So fear by its nature is always in future. It's always unreal. It has no factual existence. So whatever we are fearful of, it means that it has not yet happened. It's just our imagination. So if we are fearful of death, we are still alive, but we are fearful of death. We are fearful of job loss. We are still doing job. We are getting money, but we are fearful of job loss. We are fearful of some accident. We are fearful of some health problems. We are fearful of some wealth or relationship issues. But any of those has not yet happened. It just we are imagining that it may happen, that may happen, and we are being fearful of that. So since it is not real, we don't have to worry about it. Right? Ultimately, we have to worry about something which is happening to us right now. We don't have to worry about which is not in existence. So all fear is basically not in existence. And second way to look at it is that we have fear mainly in three categories. Like one is health. Like we are always fearful of health issues, like if any emergency come, if I get some sickness, or if I become like immobile or something like that, then what will happen? Second fear we have is about basically about wealth, that if I don't have enough money, if I don't have enough wealth, how will I take care of my material affairs? How will I take care of my survival? And then third fear we have is about death. What if my near and dear ones die, or if myself die? So how I'm going to deal with that? What is going to happen due to that? So in all this situation, if we see the basic thing element, the basic thing is about the body. Like all these fears are related to body. It all is it a bodily platform. Whether it's a health fear, fear due to wealth, or fear due to death, all these are at the bodily level. And we know very clearly that body is temporary, so is all these fears are also temporary, even if they materialize. So from that point of view also, we should not be worried about that too much, because ultimately it is all at bodily level. There is no fear at spiritual level. There is no fear at soul level. And if at all we have to be fearful, we should be fearful about our spiritual progress. We should be fearful about what if I'm not able to finish my job in this lifetime and I have to come back again. Then same thing will I have to repeat all over again. I would still be having same anxieties. I would still be having same fears in my next life. I have to still make my living in next life. I have to still earn money, and I am still be not having enough. I will still be having death fear. I will still be having health issues fear. I will still be having my financial issues fear. So everything is still going to remain all over again. So ultimate fear is that I don't want to repeat that once again. I want to get rid of that in this lifetime. So if you remind ourselves that again and again, whenever we get these fearful thoughts about this present life or this present situation, like in present material situation or coming future unreal material situation, we should remind ourselves that this is not a real fear. And I have to be fearful of the real situation, which may bring us back here. So that will actually force us to strengthen our sadhana more and more, to focus more on chanting, to focus more on hearing, to focus more on reading. And that will automatically take our time and our energy and our thoughts away from these fearful thoughts. Because the moment we engage ourselves in doing our spiritual practices, all these things goes away. These things doesn't come to our mind. Because fear is again the activity of an empty mind. If our mind is not engaged in something fruitful, then it will get into these fearful thoughts. But if we keep our mind always busy, then automatically these fearful thoughts will reduce. That will not come. So the practical approach which we can take to solve this fear is that we treat it as a risk management. So most of us who are working in corporate world or even in business, we foresee some risk, right? We know that, okay, some risk may come. I am doing some project. It may not work. It may not get delivered on time. It may have quality issues. It may have some vendor issues. If I am doing business, I may not have enough sales as I'm projecting. I may not get the raw material as I'm expecting. I may not get the support or anything which I'm expecting. So when we know that there is a risk, then we can plan, we plan for it, right? Like what are the mitigation actions, that how I can mitigate that risk? So we don't become fearful and do nothing. So we know that there is a risk which may happen, which may not happen. But if it happens, then what is my plan? What I'm going to do if that risk happens? And the solid our mitigation plan is, the more peaceful and the more focused we can be on the current task. And in most of the cases, we see that if our risk mitigation plan is solid, then most of the time risk does not even arise, because we take care of the issues according to plan so that we reduce the risk, chances of risk to get materialized. Or even if it get materialized, then we know that how to tackle it. What is my action plan? So I don't have to get panic. I don't have to get into that mode of, what I'm going to do now, I'm into that situation, because I have thought of that situation beforehand and I know that this may happen to me. So, and I have the action plan ready that if this happen, then what I'm going to do next. So when we have that, then we can be peaceful even if that risk happen or even if that risk does not happen. In both the scenarios, we will be peaceful. So all these fears which we have to treat it as a risk, and then we have to prepare a mitigation plan for each of those risks. So sometimes we can have a preventive plan also, and sometimes we can have a mitigation plan. So if we cannot prevent it, at least we should have a mitigation plan. So we'll look one by one in this from this both point of view, like how each of the situation we can take care according to that. And ultimate thing again coming down to is that we have to depend on Krishna, because bhajau re man Sri Nandanandan abhaya charanar vindare. So Krishna gives this benediction of fearlessness to the devotees. So the more we surrender to Krishna, the more we feel closer to him, the more we are in association with him, the more fearless we'll become. So again, ultimate is that. But since like at least I'm not at that pure stage and still not yet have full faith or full surrender to Krishna, so I have to have some material means as well by which I can feel little secure. Though that security is strictly at material level, anything can happen even after doing all that, but still just to give myself some comfort and some solace to my mind, I want to have that plan ready. So let's get into that. So the first most fear which we have or we can have is loss of income, like temporary loss of income due to job loss or business or some activity stopped. And especially during this corona time, we have seen that many people have lost their job temporarily, and many people were self-employed, like artists and people were dependent on jobs which need live audience or live interactions. Those people earnings have immediately stopped, completely stopped. So this is a valid fear, and this is a valid situation. I would not say fear going forward. I would not call it always a fear. So it is a valid risk. Like, as long as we are having some means of earning, that means of earning can be stopped, can be curtailed. Now it can be curtailed only temporary, because it can be curtailed permanently also, but right now we are focusing on temporary stop of that income. Because as long as we are fit, as long as we are alive, we can still do something to start our earning again once situation improves. But temporary for 3 months, 6 months, maybe up to a year, there may be a situation that I may not able to earn what I'm earning today. So what to do with that situation? So for that situation, the simplest solution is that always, always, always maintain emergency cash. So in personal finance world, what we call this as a emergency cash. So that emergency cash is how much you need to maintain. You need to maintain the emergency cash, which can take care of, depending upon your situation, whether you only person earning in the family or two people are earning in the family, how much uncertainty you have according related to your job profile or your income profile. It can be up to anywhere from 3 months to 6 months to up to maybe up to 1 year of your expenses. So if we have done our budgeting, as we discussed in the first session, so we know how much our monthly running expenses and how much our yearly periodic expenses are. So based on that, you can make a very good estimate that how much money I need to survive for 3 months, 6 months, or up to a year, so that even if I don't earn any single dime, I don't have to go anywhere. I don't have to get panic. I don't have to have any kind of fear or anxiety or problem. I have that emergency cash, which I'm not going to touch unless there is a true emergency. So I keep it separate, away from my eye, in a high-yield savings account, as we discussed, and I just leave it there. Even if I don't have to touch it in 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, or even if my whole lifetime, that is fine. I just keep it there. Rest of the money I will invest, rest of the money I can do whatever I want to do with, but this amount I'm not going to touch anytime. So if we have that, then we can have a very solid plan for this risk. So each individual can figure out that plan according to their personal situation and keep it separate. So this way we take care of this. So then second come is permanent loss of income. Now permanent loss of income will happen due to death of the earning member in the family. So if that happens, that means there is no future income, because that person has gone, and with that person, the ability to earn any future income in the family is also gone. So what to do in that situation? So again, this is a very valid situation. It can happen with anybody, and it's a very valid risk. So what is our risk mitigation plan? So for this, again, we have a very simple tool available, very simple thing available, which is called as term life insurance. So if we take a term life insurance, then it can take care of all the money which I'm supposed to earn in the future. So the way to approach it, that as soon as you start earning, or as soon as I would say you have any dependency. So because when you start earning, you may not have any loans or you may not have any dependency. So then it's fine. Even if something happens to you, then there is nobody dependent on your future income. So that's all right. There is no loss or no problem to anybody because of that. But as soon as you get married, or as soon as you have children, as soon as you have some dependent to take care of, then it's very, very important to have a life insurance, because death can happen anytime. It will not come saying that, okay, I will come after 50 years, 60 years, or 70 years of your age. It can happen anytime. And we have seen in any number of examples every day in front of us. But it's still, in my experience so far, I have seen that very, very less number of people have enough life insurance. Very, very rare. Even in devotee community, even in people who are working in IT, even people who are very educated, all walks of life, many people are very, very underinsured. So that is a very simple thing which we can take care of, you know, and be away from all the anxiety, not for ourselves, but for our family members or for our dependents. So term insurance comes in various terms. Is it called as term insurance? It comes in various terms, like 5 year, 10 year, 15 year, 20 year, and up maximum up to 30 years. So let's say if you are 30 year old and you take a 30 year life insurance, then it will covers you up to the age of 60. That is your normal retirement age. So if you take a policy and then your premium get fixed at the beginning. So whatever is the premium at the beginning, the same premium remains for entire duration of the life, for whole 30 years. And take pure life insurance, term life insurance, so that the premium is very low. So for somebody who is 30 year old, healthy, with no alcohol or tobacco habits, he can get $1 million insurance just for $30-$35 per month. So it's very, very cheap, and it's cheaper than your auto insurance. Now, many people say, I'm not going to die so early. Why I pay $30 per month and don't get anything in return? So that is very foolish argument, you know, because we value our, auto insurance we are taking, home insurance we are taking, because that is mandated by law. Now, life insurance is not mandated by law. So that's why we are taking our life for free. On the other hand, life is the most valuable thing which we have. And for auto insurance, we are paying hundreds of dollars every month, but we are not ready to pay $30-$40 for protecting our life. And auto insurance is not giving you any insurance. Like, it's just covering for the damage in occurs in that accident. That is up to $30,000, $40,000, $50,000. That's it. And that's not going to take care of any of your future problems. But if you take a life insurance, enough life insurance, even if you go on at any age, any of your family members, your spouse, your children, your parents, they don't have to go out in front of anybody. Many a time we see that, especially in US, anytime any person, young person die, immediately we see a GoFundMe request. And I feel so sad seeing that. You know, why is that? People who are working in IT, who are working, having six-figure jobs, and seems to be very educated, and if something like that happened to them, immediately a GoFundMe request comes that they don't have anything to take care of their family. So that's a very pity situation, because it can be taken care by a very simple thing, like, as I said, like $30-$50 per month, and you secure yourself for $500K, $700K, $1 million, and then you don't have to look anywhere. And just, it's not just for your dependent or your family members, it's for us also. Like, just imagine if we don't have life insurance, and if we meet with a death, and if Krishna is merciful, he gives us some time before we leave our body, then what thought is going to our mind? Immediate thought would be, what will happen to my family? What will happen to my dependent? We can't remember Krishna in that scenario. It's very hard. But if we have a life insurance, then we can be peaceful. Okay, I had to die one day anyway. My time has come, and I have taken care of my responsibilities. I have taken care of my dependents. So, okay, let me remember Krishna, and that's it. So please, please, please any of you who don't have enough insurance, so again, you have to look at your personal situation. It's again depend person to person, how much assets you already have. And again, important is how much liquid assets you have. Because if you have too much real estate, that's not going to help in this situation. The moment you are gone, your wife, your children cannot sell your property and have their meal and all their running expenses from next month onward, right? So you have to have liquid assets which can be immediately become available to them for their use as soon as possible. So look at your individual situation, how much liquid assets you already have, how much money you have, how much is your monthly expenses, how much money you expect that your children will need in future, and do you have that enough? And if not, then take the term life insurance of whatever shortfalls you have. And don't rely on employer life insurance for two reasons. One is employer life insurance is very minimal. That is mostly up to one or two times of your annual income. So that is not going to be enough. Second, job loss can happen anytime. And the moment you leave your job, your insurance will stop. And even if you're going to join your next job, there is always going to be a gap in between. So death can happen after 5 p.m. on your last working day from your current job. And even if you're joining your job next day morning 8 a.m., there is still time from 5 p.m. to 8 a.m. next day. And death can happen that time also. So don't rely only on employer insurance. That is my request. Have your personal insurance, which is always with you. No matter whether you are working, you are not working, you are in job, you are not in job. So that will always be there. Third thing, always cover your liabilities. So if you have mortgage or any other loans, then make sure that you have enough insurance to cover that. Because once the earning member dies, still that liability has to be carried off. It's not like that your house becomes free if you die. Your dependent still has to pay mortgage. They still have to clear off the mortgage to remain in that house. So make sure that all your debts are covered by insurance so that they don't have to live anywhere. They can still continue to live in the same house where you are living right now. So if you take care of these basic points, then you can be like less fearful or anxiety free about fear of death. Okay. So we covered fear of job loss.
Oh, I have a question.
Death. Yes, Prabhuji.
Professional people can insure income so that if you are making 200,000, you can insure up to maybe 100,000, 150,000. So if you lose because you can't see eyes or something like that, there is a good insurance you have. Yes. For some people.
Right. Yeah. So yeah, that is also an option we can go for, especially for business people. That is more relevant rather than salaried people. Yeah. Right. Thank you, Prabhuji. So then next fear is about the health, right? What will happen if I become sick? And with that sickness, two things will happen. One is that my ability to earn and the amount of money I'm going to spend to get myself cured. So it would be like a two-way impact if we get seriously ill or seriously sick, right? So for that, again, we can take help of proper insurance planning, because again, it's a valid risk and it will happen in everybody's life, no matter what, how much we are careful about our health, because as long as we are in this material world, we cannot avoid disease. So it's going to happen at any some point in our life, right? If it doesn't happen, it's well and good, but we have to assume that it will happen. So first thing first is that, again, prevention, because on health side, at least we can take some preventive measures, and our Krishna consciousness lifestyle is naturally allows us to remain healthy. because we don't drink, don't take outside food. We always eat home cooked Krishna Prasadam, and we don't take any intoxication. We don't eat meat, and we do wake up early, and we have a very regulated lifestyle. So all we do fasting. So all these parameters naturally promotes good health. So if we follow all these principles seriously, then anyway, we can avoid most of the health issues. But still, if it happens, then again, we can rely on health insurance. So again, in this, for those who are in jobs, I think it's very easy. Most of the employers provide health insurance coverage at a nominal cost. And so we can take advantage of that as long as we are in the job. Now, if we lose job, we have two options, even if temporary, if we lose the job. Number one option is that you can still continue the same insurance which your employer is providing, even if you lose the job or even if you get fired, voluntarily as well as both involuntarily. In both scenarios, you can still continue the same insurance at the same premium. Like you have to pay premium from your own pocket after the job loss, but at least you can continue same benefits at the same premium for up to 6 months to 1 year. So by the time you get new job or you get settled, you can still continue that same insurance. And second option is that you can buy from marketplace, like healthcare.gov. You can go and you can buy insurance from marketplace also, if it is cheaper than what you are being provided from your employer. So both of the options are there. So job or no job, we can still get ourselves insured. Now, in insurance, there are multiple options are there. So if you have already aware, most of you must be already aware that you have high deductible plans and low deductible plans, right? So the way high deductible plan works is that you pay upfront before your plan starts paying. So you pay certain amount from your own pocket, let's say $3,000, $1,200, $400, $4,000, whatever the amount is for your employer plan. And you pay that before your plan starts paying. And all the plans will pay for preventive measures 100%. So your annual checkups will be paid without any cost to you. All your vaccines will be paid at any cost to you. So make sure that you get your annual checkup done every year without fail, because there is no cost to you. You are already paying insurance premium for that. And there is no additional cost for you to go for annual checkup. So if you go for annual checkup every day, you can detect any future problems early on. So even if you are young and healthy, you don't have any issue, still go for it. It just takes 1 hour every year, and at least you can be peaceful that yes, all my vital parameters and blood reports and everything is okay. And so now question may arise that if I fall sick, then since I have out of pocket expenses before my plans pay, I have to pay for it, right? So for that purpose, something else is there to our help, which is called HSA, like health savings account. Most of you who are in job must be already having that. So in that account, we can deposit some money every month, every paycheck. And in most cases, employer also deposit some money in that account. And we can use that money for any our health expenses. Now that money, we can keep in that account only up to the extent which we have our responsibility. So for example, if your family out of pocket is $10,000, so we can keep $10,000 balance in our HSA all the time. So if we have any disease or any problems in a year and we spend some money out of it, then we make sure that we reach that figure. We contribute more and we reach that figure. And once you reach that figure, at that time, maybe then you may not contribute any further. It's up to you. Because in worst case scenario, then you are covered. Because let's say even if you meet with cancer or any other dreaded disease where you have to spend hundreds and thousands of dollars, the plan will be responsible for paying all of that except that your responsibility, which is 10,000, 5,000, 12,000, whatever that amount is. So once you are out of that limit, then everything else is paid by plan. So just maintain that balance in HSA so that any of your other savings, any of your other money or assets which you have, you don't have to touch in case of any emergency related to health. So this will take care of as long as you are in job. Now, as you get retired, or as you get early retirement or near the retirement age, then again two scenarios. Like if we take early retirement, let's say before age 60, then we can take the health insurance plan from marketplace. So in marketplace, the health insurance premium is decided by based on your annual income. So if your annual income is less, you pay less premium. If your annual income is more, then you pay more premium. So once we take early retirement, our annual income will become very less. So in that case, at a very cheap premium, we will get the very good health insurance. So we can take that. And as you reach retirement age, then you can take Medicare and Medicaid depending upon your situation. So there are various options in that. So we won't cover all of that in this particular session. But if you need any other information on that, we can discuss offline. But make sure that you enroll in Medicare and Medicaid as you reach your retirement age. Again, it's state specific. So you have to look into which state you are living. And accordingly, in that state, according to the state guideline, you have to get yourself enrolled. But again, it's a very, very low cost insurance, like around $140 to $200 per month per person. And you get covered for both in hospital expenses and out of office hospital expenses. And as I said in last session, like in worst case scenario, let's say if you don't have any assets at all, you are totally kind of a bankrupt kind of person, that you don't have any liquid assets or anything, and you are age 65 plus, then you can involve yourself in Medicaid, and then government will take care of all your health expenses. You don't have to pay a penny, either for premium or for the treatment. So these are the two things. Now, one more scenario is there in which you may need assisted living. So for example, in old age, you get some disease, let's say paralysis or advanced stage cancer or something like that, where you are not able to take care of yourself. And then you need some assistance. So in US, we know that how expensive the personal care is. So if you need to live in an assistant care facility or a nursing home, or you have to have a nurse 24/7 by your side, then it can be very costly. Like it could run into $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 per year very easily. So in that scenario, what one option we have is what is called as long-term care insurance, LTC, in short it is called. So when we take life insurance, and if you are above age 50, 55, then there is an option to take long-term care rider along with your policy, or you can separately buy a long-term care policy as well. Because there is no point in buying this policy when you are young, because probability of needing long-term care at the very young age is very, very rare. So only in the advanced age, mostly it will need it. So at that time, at an appropriate age, I would say after 55, you should, if you are planning to live in US, then you should look for this particular option, like taking a long-term care policy. Because again, the concept is if you buy little early, then you will get it little cheaper. But if you wait till 65, 70, and then go for buying a long-term care, then it will be very, very expensive. So again, various options are there. You have to take help of some professional insurance agent, which can guide you through the various options available in the market. But this is something which we can take, and that way we can make ourselves comfortable as far as financial stress is concerned in old age. And if we have enough savings from our IUL policy or our 401k or our social security is enough, then all that money can be utilized for long-term care if needed. So that is also there. And in some states, there are some state partnership plans are there. So where state provides assistance in getting the premium for this. And one more option is that once you retire, then check with your employer, because most of the employer offer long-term care insurance, cheap long-term care insurance as part of their retirement offerings. So just like they offer health insurance as long as you are working there, they offer long-term care insurance once you retired from them. So in that case, we can get a very good deal. So check with your employer when you are retiring. If they offer something like that, then you can make use of that as well. So that would be very handy. And one thing is there that for critical illness and terminal illness, you can add it as a rider in your term insurance policy. So the way it works is that for term insurance, let's say you have $1 million insurance. So a part of it, like 40 or 50% of it, they will give if you are detected with any terminal illness or a critical illness. So if you get, let's say, detected with a cancer or some organ failure or something like that, then you will immediately get that one amount of money, which can be used for any long-term care or any treatment cost, which is not covered otherwise. Or it can provide some income for you to take care of, because if you are met with critical illness, then you may not be able to go to job, you may not be able to earn anything. So in that case, that particular amount which you get from your rider, from your life insurance policy, that can take care of your expenses, monthly and other family expenses. So by taking all these measures, we can be very, very sure about any health situation which may arise, which will not affect my plan, which will not affect my goal, which will not affect my any of other savings. Just by having these measures in this insurance like this, we can make sure that if any health situation arises, whether it's small or big, at any age, I will not be impacted financially due to that. So very simple and very easy, and you don't have to make too much effort for that. It's just one time thing and we can take care of that. Okay. So the next risk we may see is like accidents or house fires, right? Like our house get damaged due to earthquake, flood, hurricane or fire or something like that. So again, these two things are necessary, like a car and a house is a need and we need to maintain it. And if we have any problems, then we may have to make sure that without spending any money from our own pocket, we get the status quo back, whatever happened, whatever loss has happened. So for that, it's a mandatory most of the places. So everybody, I hope, have that auto insurance and homeowner insurance or a renter's insurance, whatever is applicable. So only I will share a few tips so that these insurance are meaningful and you don't get any surprise if you meet with any claim situation. So one tip is that for both these insurance, always shop around at every renewal. So it don't take much time. Shopping around, make sure that you are getting the best rate always, like you are not overpaying. So you just take half an hour or 1 hour online and you can make sure that you are still getting the best rate, and that's it. You can combine this policy so that you get better discount. And in auto insurance, make sure that you choose medical pay option. So in each insurance, you have that medical pay option, which you can select for up to $1,000, $2,000 or $5,000, whichever is allowed as per your policy. And it costs very less, like $10 per 6 months or something like that, $10 to $20 per 6 months. The advantage is that if you meet with any accident and if there is any medical need, then you will get double paid. Like you will get paid from your own policy if you have selected MedPay up to that amount. And then if you are not at fault, then you will get the damages, like bodily injury damages. From that also, you will get the same amount, like that you will get the full amount. So that way, just by having it, it will give us little more room if we meet with any accident. And if you are having a new cars and you are paying too much of comprehensive insurance, and so one way to reduce that is that you increase your deductible. So instead of having $250 or $500 standard deductible, you can have up to $2,000, $3,000, whatever you feel comfortable. The higher the deductible, the lower the premium is. So you can see that But if you are driving an old car, then you can avoid the comprehensive insurance altogether. So then no need to get that. Similarly, for home insurance, make sure that all your limits are accurate, because in home insurance, there are so many limits are there. Like if you're in a single family, then you will have the outside damage, roof damage, inside damage, personal belonging damage, liability insurance. So all those things will be there. So make sure that each of those limits are practical and as per your situation. Because insurance company, when you get the quote, they just put random default limits. And sometimes those limits may be very higher. So for example, in my own case, when I rent the default default home insurance quote, it came to $600. But when I looked at the limit and then I played around with it to suit my need, it came down to $250, like less than half. So what I found, they put liability is $1 million. So let's say somebody comes to your house for repairing or something, and if he or some guest or somebody who get some injury, they may sue you. So for that, they put $1 million. Again, the probability of that is very low. If you call any licensed professional, they have their own insurance. So they don't rely on your insurance to protect themselves while they are doing the job. So we can keep that to reasonable limit, like 300K or something. Similarly, personal belongings, make sure that your personal belongings are accurate. Sometimes what they do, based on the house price, let's say if you are living in a 600K house, by default, they would put personal belongings as 200K to 50K. Now that may not be the case based on how simple we are living. So for my example, my entire house personal belonging is not more than $5,000-$7,000. Like even if my entire house get burned, all my personal belongings gone, I can put that back in $7,000 again. So, and then, so I reduced that to minimum. So they had minimum as $10,000. So that was their minimum. So I said, okay, let's put to the minimum. So that way again, the premium got reduced a lot. So like that, just see whatever is there and is accurate to your situation. And that way you can optimize your premium. And one other thing, if you are living in a townhouse, then your HOA will cover a lot of insurance, like for all outside, like roof damage, outside structure, and everything is covered by HOA insurance. So make sure that there is no duplicity, like there is no duplicate coverage between your HOA policy and your own personal policy. So that way you are not paying unnecessary premium. So make sure that you get the copy of your HOA insurance and then share it with your agent and make sure that they are not duplicating any coverage. So with these tips, you can save and make sure that you have the most accurate and efficient home and auto insurance. And for all of these, like auto, home, and life insurance, you can go to policygenius.com. So PolicyGenius, policygenius.com. So this particular site can give you quotes for like various life insurance companies for your term life insurance policy, as well as it can give you combined quotes for your auto and home insurance. So every 6 months or every year, when you want to shop around, don't go to 10 different sites. You just go to policyinsurance.com, you submit your current policy document to them, fill a simple form, and then they will shop around and they will come back with a quote, comparison quote from various vendors. And that way you can then select what you need. And all that is at no cost to us. And if needed, the personal agent is available on phone for further discussion as well. So that way we can make our life simple. We don't have to run around to 10 different places to get these things done.
Prabhu, I have a question.
Yes, Prabhu.
Umbrella insurance. Umbrella insurance.
Yes. Yeah.
We cover a lot more, risks and things like
yeah.
that. Other one is flood insurance.
Yeah.
A lot of people forget to get their flood insurance.
Right.
And a lot
right.
of things are happening these days that you want to make sure you have that insurance.
Right.
That is given
right.
by federal government, I think, flood
yes.
insurance.
Yeah. So flood insurance, again, depending upon the zone you are living in, if you are susceptible yes. to flood and you are in flood zone, then especially, then definitely you should go for that. So I tried to cover all the major scenarios, but depending upon where you are living, what your personal situation is, there may be some other insurance which you may need to take. But the bottom line is, for all problems which you can face in material life, there is an insurance. Because material people, karmi people also don't want to feel distress because of all these things. So they have created insurance for each and everything. Now you will not imagine for what all kind of things insurance are available in the market.
Yeah.
I don't want to go into that, but anything which you are fearful of, anything which you can think that, oh, what happened if I lose this, then don't fear. It's a risk. Cover that risk. And just find the most efficient and cheapest way of insurance to it. And the way I covered it, I just told you the most efficient and the cheapest way of doing it, because there are many products are available in the market which may not be suitable, which may be very costly. And if you go for that, instead of solving the problem, you may increase the problem. So for example, in India, most of the people are having LIC policies, and those LIC policies are 50,000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees, 5 lakh rupees, that kind of insurance. Now that does not even cover your funeral expenses normally. So what kind of insurance, what kind of useful insurance is that? So now two most important point I want to cover before I conclude today's topic. One thing is that always make sure that you keep a proper account of all this, because there is no point of having an insurance policy and your family members don't know about it. And I have seen this situation in my personal life as well. Person died, family member does not even know that he had a life insurance policy. Or even if they know, they had, oh, he had some life insurance policy. Now, I don't know which policy, where it is, what it is, no idea at all. So what use of that?
So probably what is the best way to communicate that to the family?
Yeah, so we don't have to be very fancy about it. You can take very simple approach. Like what I do, I have a simple Word document where I list all my financial account details. So you don't have to mention the value or anything. You just mention what you have, what is the account number or the identifying information, policy number or whatever, and what is the contact number, the toll-free number and the email ID of that particular company. If you just document these things on a piece of paper and then maybe have a printout, share it with your near and dear ones or share it electronically. And always make sure that you share with at least one person outside of your immediate family. Because you are going on a car trip, you are going on a vacation and entire family may die together.
Absolutely.
So at least one person outside of immediate family should also have access to that information. And again, you don't have to be fearful about that. That, as I said, you don't have to disclose the values of it. You just have to disclose the identity of it, like what it is. So that they can take care of it, they can chase the companies, or they can make sure that the right people get access to it if you are not there. And if you want to do it in a more technical and proper way, then you can make help of will and estate planning. So that is another topic which we may not be able to cover today, but I will just give you some tip that if you approach any local family lawyer in your area, then with a very small, like if you don't have too much of a headaches, too many properties, multi-state properties and this and that, then with just $500 to $600, you can get all your will, health, power of attorney and your estate planning and everything done and documented legally, notarized, authorized, everything. And then you can be completely peaceful. But basic thing is to document and share. These two things are the most important. Because even when I do personal counseling, then I have to remind people. And when I ask Prabhu, what policy you have? And they go completely blank. Even the person who has taken the policy goes completely blank. Forget about the family members. So, oh, I have to look for the login ID. I have to look for the password. This, that means what policy? Oh, I don't know what policy. How much sum insured? I don't know how much sum insured. So please don't do that. Document everything. And it, as I said, very simple, just piece of paper, just nicely put it down and just share it. That's it. But very, very important. If you don't do it, then there is no point of doing all these things. So, yeah.
Next question. Somebody's asking that the will and trust, what is the difference? Do we need both?
Yeah, so will is basically what, so there are two kind of will. One is living will and one is the last will. So living will is something which you can mention that as I'm living, what I want to do with all my assets. So that is what it is called as a living will. And the last will is something which comes into effect only after person's death. So in that you can specify what you want to do with all your assets. So you can mention, I want to give this and this to this, give this and this to this and this to that. Or you can mention default successor, like whether your spouse, children, grandchildren, whatever the case may be. And another advantage of documenting it is that, or another way of doing it, it is that any life insurance policy you have, the beneficiary which you mentioned on the policy takes precedence, no matter what you put on the will. So in your policy, if you mentioned beneficiary as your spouse, then she will get the amount after your death. So, and like for, similarly for your example, like 401k or any of your bank accounts, wherever you have put a nomination or a beneficiary, so that person or that entity takes the precedence. Only if something is undocumented, then will come into picture. And trust is needed in the scenario where your children are minor. So for example, in US, if both the parents die due to some accident or something, and if their children are minor, then government take custody of them and send them to foster care. Nobody can take their custody unless you have documented will and appointed a guardian for your minor children. So if you don't have that, then by default, those children will go to foster care. And then you have to do a long legal battle to get their custody. And that is a very painful situation. But just by doing a simple will, you can take care of that very easily. And similarly, whatever house you are living in, if your children are minor and then both of you die, let's say, I'm assuming, let's say you are a joint owner, both husband and wife are the joint owner of the property right now. But if both of you die and your children are minor, then again, that house has to go through legal proceeding before that can be given to your children. And since children are minor, that cannot even be given to them. So that's where the trust or estate planning comes into picture. So in that way, you can take care of that as you are living. You can appoint a trustee. You can document what will happen in case both of you die, who will take care of ownership of these, who will take care of your children. All that you can specify in that, so that without going to court, without going to attorney, without hiring anybody, all those matters can be taken care of. So in short, that is the importance of will and estate planning.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Prabhuji, question. I had the question about whether we just need a will or we should also look into trust. So I think kind of you answered it just now. Yeah. If we have a house, then probably we should go for trust also.
Yeah, house and minor children. So these are the two conditions in which a trust is always good. But if you have adult children, and then you can make them as a joint owner in your property. So that way, even if something happens to both of you, they are still able to take the ownership. But if your children are not mature yet and not up to date age, then I would definitely recommend to have a trust.
Okay. Okay. And if the house is on just, let's say, my name only, then I should cover this risk with a will or even for that trust for the wife?
No, at least wife you should include as a joint owner.
Okay.
Yeah, that is the easiest way to have at least. So because if both of you, the probability of dying both together is very less. So at least if one is surviving, then also it's covered. Like no court no proceedings are needed. Yeah.
Right. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Yeah.
Prabhuji, you mentioned about if person loses a job, they can easily get the insurance at, they can continue insurance at same premium. Were you referring to Cobra?
Yes, yes, Prabhuji.
And Cobra, I thought Cobra, in case your employer subsidizes insurance, the premium increases as you shift to Cobra.
No, no. The purpose of Cobra is that you get the insurance at the same terms and condition up to a certain point. That is the protection which we have in case we lose job voluntary or involuntary.
Even voluntarily, okay.
Yeah, right.
Ranjit, go ahead, question.
Yes.
Thank you, Shri Prabhu. So you mentioned about several insurances for the family. We have an extended family, which is ISKCON. Right. And many times devotees have done insurance policies where after their death, certain percentage or all of it goes to the institution. So can a policy be broken into two, where is like, I want 50% to go to my family, I want 50% going to ISKCON?
Yeah, it's very, very easy, Prabhuji. You can just mention beneficiary and you can have as many beneficiary in your policy as you want. And you can break up percentage wise, how much you want to give to whom. So that way, no further documentation needed, no further formality needed. As soon as claim is made, that money will be distributed accordingly as per your mandate. So while you are living, you can mention your beneficiaries accordingly. You can mention the trust, their ID and address, and how much percentage you want to give. And that's taken care of.
So Prabhuji, if I piggyback into what you mentioned earlier, if I have beneficiaries in all my assets and properties, then I do not need a will at all. Is that true?
Technically, yes. If you have mentioned everything, like you have beneficiaries and nominations mentioned for all your assets, and you have shared that information with them. So then technically, yes, you don't need a will.
The custodial of the asset or the beneficiary themselves or both?
No, beneficiary. And again, the beneficiary may die as well, or he may die before you or after you. So you just have to make sure that you keep your beneficiary up to date as you move along. So initially you may have put somebody, but as life situation changes, make sure that you remember to update that as we move along. Because as I said, like I found many people who themselves don't know once they buy something and they forget, you know, where it is, what it is. So that way, if we keep it documented and review it like once in a 2 year or something like that, or any situation change, any new member come into family, any person dies in the family, something like that. So that way, if we keep it updated, then no issues. It should be current. Yeah. And one more point I want to mention for the people who have elderly parents in India. So you might be having some fear about their health issues and cost of their health, right? So I will share a very little secret, which very few people know. So the way to insure them is through a nationalized bank. So all the nationalized bank in India, SBI, Union Bank, Canara Bank, Bank of India, all these nationalized bank, if they have an account in any of those banks, then they can get a health group insurance policy from that bank. Now, nobody will tell this. Even if you go to bank branch, normally they will not tell this. It's not mentioned anywhere on their website, but it's a government law. Each bank must provide a group health insurance policy to all its members, all its account holder, and that is renewable lifelong without any questions. So you don't have to worry even if your parents survive 80, 85, 90 years old, whatever the age is, this will be get renewed. And the premium is very, very cheap. Like for my parents, they are into like father is 69, mother is 64. For 5 lakh rupees each, I just pay 7,000 rupees per year for each of them. So 7,000, 14,000, I get cover of 5 lakhs each, and that is guaranteed to renew each year. So please make use of it. And if they get enrolled before 65, well and good. Then you don't have to worry at all. You don't have to worry at all. It will be renewed lifelong.
Is there an option to enroll after 65 also, Prabhu?
You have to check with the banks. There may be option, for before 65, I'm damn sure that because I have personally done it and I have the policy and many of my friends and acquaintance I have recommended and they took it. So I personally know. And I found that SBI generally just simply say that we don't have it, like in at least 3 or 4 cases I know. But Canara Bank and Union Bank definitely have it, and they definitely share with you if you go and approach them that I need this group life insurance policy. So any of you who have parents in India, if you are paying private insurance thousands of rupees and still not having peace of mind, then you can go this route. Don't cancel your old policy until you get this new policy, and you can migrate your old policy to the new policy, because in India now laws support portability of health insurance policies. So if you have a no claim history on your current policy, then you can just transport that policy to this new policy.
That's wonderful, Prabhu. So that anybody having account can get it. That's amazing.
Yeah. And even my parents are not having account. So I opened account for them. I keep minimum balances there, and then we get this policy. So it's really, really helpful and very, very like hardly anybody knows about it. So I was very like Krishna was very merciful that he somehow that information came across me.
You mentioned, Prabhu, about that if something happens to your house, you had about $7,000 worth of value. Now, there could be two school of thoughts. One is, simple living is good, but at the same time, if Krishna has blessed me with so much money, maybe I can have hundreds and thousands of dollars worth of stuff at home. and if I can manage it, what's wrong?
Yes. So my understanding for that, based on whatever I have read and heard Srila Prabhupada, is that we should not have more than what is necessary. So even though Krishna has provided us more, like I shared in the very first slide of this presentation in the first session, whatever extra we get beyond our need should be spent in Krishna's service. And we already, most of the time hear that argument of Yukta Vairagya, but my understanding of that is that Yukta Vairagya is something, if you lose it at a drop of a hat, there should not be a slightest iota of anxiety or iota of doubt or iota of lamentation in your mind. If we are up to that level, then yes, no problem, because Krishna has provided all the opulence to Yudhishthir Maharaj, Krishna has provided all the opulence to Parikshit Maharaj, to Ambarish Maharaj, but they were ready to leave it at the moment's notice. But my consciousness is not like that. If I lose my iPhone, then I will not be able to sleep for 2 days. So if my consciousness is at that level, then better not have iPhone. I have a Motorola $120 phone. Even if it gets lost, I can replace it without any anxiety. So my approach is that, Prabhuji, like keep it simple. If it is not needed, yes, whatever is needed, we will have it. We have the example of Avanti Brahmana also. So we don't want to be miser, but again, we have to very clearly evaluate whether I'm going into sense gratification by justifying that, oh, Krishna has given me. So I am not authorized to use it for myself. If Krishna has given me, then it's for use of Krishna and the devotees, not for myself. For myself, I always need to use whatever is bare minimum needed. So that is my understanding on that.
Prabhuji, can we contact you if we have any questions?
Yes, Prabhuji, definitely. I will share my contact details in chat.
So if anybody has any questions, please raise your hand. Amika Mataji has a question.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Dhanwad Pranam Jai Shila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna. So Prabhuji, thank you for sharing that, you know, the tip about the health insurance for the parents. That's very, very good tip, because, you know, I have a mother-in-law who is elderly, lives by herself in India. So, so you just go to the bank and ask them. And I guess in some case, SBI probably will not give you the information. But I think based on your discussion, it seems like Canara Bank will be more, you know, like, I think beneficial. I think they are open. Right. So right. I guess just open an account in Canara Bank and request right. for the health insurance information.
Yes. Yeah, my parents personally have in Canara Bank, and then I have few devotee friends and other previous colleagues as well. They have in Union Bank and Canara Bank. So for these two banks, I'm definitely sure. But as per government law, it should be for all nationalized banks. So you, if you have any account in any nationalized bank already, then first start with them. And if you are not successful, then you may go for any of these banks.
And it is only for the elderly parents or any?
No, anybody. Any account holder, irrespective of anybody.
Right, because my brother is a brahmachari, you know, but obviously even he is a brahmachari, he has a bank account, but I don't think so. He's a health insurance. So I think I will share this information with him also.
Yes, definitely.
Okay, Prabhuji, thank you. And one more question. I think I missed the second session, and you might have already discussed about this. So how about investing into 529 for the college education? Did you cover that in the second part? What is your advice on that?
Yeah, I did not cover it specifically, but so 529, there are few points I will share that now, then you can evaluate based on your personal situation. So 529, number one is that it is state specific. So if you move around states, you have to keep moving your 529 with you. That is one thing. All state plans are not same. Some states offer very good options and good choice and with very less expense, but some state plans are not that good. Third is some states offer tax incentives. So that may be added benefit, but some states don't offer any tax benefit. So that if you invest in 529 in those states, then you are not getting any extra benefit. Another point is that if as a, like mostly for our Indian background families who are first generation devotee here and still not US citizen or green card holder, so then again, always an anxiety to go back or possibility to go back. So in that case, again, 529 would not help, because that can be used only for universities in US or foreign universities recognized by US, which are very few. Like in London, Singapore, they have few, but not beyond that. So looking at all these points, you have to see whether how practical and feasible it is for you, your situation. So it's not for everybody. Like 529 is not like something which anybody can go for it.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Prabhu, so the 529, I understand, is after-tax money, right?
Yes.
So
no, why... in some cases, state gives tax incentive. So if you invest, they take that off from your taxable income, some amount, like $2,000, $4,000, whatever.
Okay.
Yeah.
I actually got logged off for a second. That's why I don't know if you covered this, but if it is after tax money, I think in state of New Jersey, it's after tax money. So if you're paying after tax money, or if you're contributing after tax money in it while withdrawing, is there, and I think logically there shouldn't be any tax implications, right?
Yeah. So that is the advantage, like 529 money grows tax free. So when you withdraw for college purpose, but the only thing is that you can use it only for the college education purpose, not for anything else. So for example, if your kid, let's say one kid does not need that money, then you, other kid can use it, or your grandchildren can use it, but still it has to be spent on college education or higher education purpose only. You can't withdraw it to pay off your mortgage. You can't withdraw it to pay off any of your other expenses.
So hopefully Krishna's mercy, none of the growing kids should ever be in the situation of not going to college or finishing their education. But Prabhu, if there is any instance of family, if certain kid doesn't want to go to college or university and their parents have invested in, the 529 plan, then what happens to such, money that's invested in it?
If you withdraw it again, the penalty rules will apply depending upon the state rules. So you have to pay that penalty and get that money.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And 529 just works like any other, investment. It's a mutual
fund, like 401k Roth IRA. You pick what investment you want, how risky investment you plan. So you can choose from various range like equity and the balanced fund and the target fund, like target retirement fund. They have target college fund. So for example, the year in which your kid is going to go to college, they have plans according to that particular year. So some options like that are there in that.
Okay. And if the money that's there available in it, if the entire amount is not needed, so, say if there is $300,000 in it, but the college education is just worth about 100,000, or, you plan it, but I'm just saying, if any surplus is not used, then you pay tax on it, or if, penalty.
So excess can be transferred to siblings or grandchildren to be used in future. But if you withdraw it, then for other purpose, then you are subjected to individual tax laws and penalty laws of the state.
Okay.
In this 559, I asked a question to Bank of America sometime back. And so there is a principal part and there is a income part of it. Principal part, you already paid the taxes. So when you withdraw it, so you're getting the advantage of only the income with the tax advantage.
Right.
But if you withdraw, would you end up paying the penalty on the principal also if you withdraw it?
No. Because again, it depends on state to state. So some states which are offering tax intensive, they may have rules to have penalty on principal also. But technically, if it is post-tax money, then the penalty should be on the gains, not on the principal. But penalty may still be applied on the whole amount because the purpose of the whole amount is for college education. So though tax may not be applied, but penalty may still be applicable for the whole amount. But again, you have to check state laws for that. I'm not very conversant.
Yeah, I didn't ask the Bank of America. They could not get the answer.
You have to do your own. And one another rule is that don't invest in anything which you don't understand yourself. Just by the tips or my friend has done it, my relative has done it, he gave me this tip, it works for him. Because most of the time we make our investment decision based on these factors. So my humble advice to you that unless you understand yourself what you are getting into, don't go into it. Better to not go into it. Ask 100 questions. Unless and until that person satisfies all your questions and you understand everything, what you are doing, how it will work, what are the implications, what are the pros, cons, everything. Unless and until you don't understand everything, don't go for it.
Okay. There's another question looking like related. People
investing. Bro, thank you so much for the answer. Thank you so much, bro.
Yeah. Thank you, Prabhuji.
There is a question saying that in the chat room, saying that they have investment property in India. Do we need to declare in US?
Technically, yes. Any global income you are supposed to declare in US.
They are paying
taxes. If you are getting a rent in India, then you are supposed to declare that in US income tax returns.
Because India charges the taxes at source itself usually.
Yeah, so whatever you paid there, you can get a foreign tax credit, but still you have to show an account for that in when you file return here.
Okay. Well, I hope that question answered. Otherwise, you can raise the hand. Alkamata, you have a question?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. You mentioned about retired individuals get taken care by the government, but that is by taking Medicaid. So would you know actually what are the eligibility criteria? Like who can apply for Medicaid?
Yeah, I mentioned that in last session. So you have to be above 65 with liquid asset less than $2,000. So you can have your house, you can have your car, you can have furniture, your appliances and all those things, but your bank balance or investment or anything, stock, mutual fund, bank balance, cash in hand, all of that should be less than $2,000. So if you are, if someone in that situation, then they are mostly eligible for Medicaid.
Thank you,
Prabhuji. Yeah.
Krishna Prabhuji, I have a question.
Yes,
so Prabhuji, you talked about emergency fund, right? 6 months to a year. So what's the best place to park that money, especially US savings account and all are giving very peanuts, right? Like 3.5.
I mentioned in my first session. So you can open the account in H.M. Bradley Bank, which offers up to 3% interest. So you can park your emergency cash there. HMBradley.com.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Anybody else has question?
Prabhuji, I can go with a lot of questions, but I'll just ask one. Is there any benefit of having a whole life plan for children? I've heard it's...
I will tell you. So as I touched upon in my second session, only a whole life plan we can take is index universal life, depending upon the parameters like pros and cons, which I mentioned. So if you fit the bill in those parameters, then that is the only whole life plan we should go for, not like guaranteed return whole life plan or variable universal life plan. Those are not good. So we should not go for those. But we can go for index universal life plan if you fit the bill of all the pros and cons which I explained.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Thank you for answering the 529 question. The question I have is, you mentioned about long-term care plan. You know, anybody who is like, you know, over 55, they can take that plan for the long-term care facility. But what about when you are still working? You know, most of us are going to work until 50, 60, whatever, you know. So while you are working, and let's say if you come and meet some accident or you are disabled, you are not able to work. So would you recommend that long-term disability plan? Because, you know, most of the employer, they pay for the short-term disability. But if you can explain that a little bit more, that would be helpful.
Yeah, so for that, in term life insurance policy, there is something. So for example, like if you become 100% disabled, so they have parameters like both your legs are not working, both your eyes are not working, or both your hands are not working. So like that, it means that you are beyond your capability to work. So in that case, term life insurance policy has riders which gives you lump sum amount. So when we take term life insurance policy, we can have these riders, actually one critical illness rider, one terminal illness rider, and one is a disability rider. So we can check for these three things, and that comes very cheap.
Okay. Yeah. So as you say, you know.
Yeah. So you get lump sum amount if you met with any such situation. Like you, let's say even in young age, you met with cancer or something like that, terminal illness. So in that case also, then you will get.
Okay. Okay. So this will be part of your term insurance, but let's say I bought my life insurance 10 years ago and I didn't know. I think, can I go back and ask them to add this riders to my insurance policy, the term insurance policy?
You can check. I would doubt they will allow into the current insurance policy, but again, it depends on the plan. So definitely worth a check. To go and ask. They may do underwriting again, depending upon your current age and medical condition, but most of the term policy in, like at least in today's time, they come by default with these riders, most. So okay. That's why I said that you check for it when you buy, that it includes those riders in it, because most of the policies by default come with those.
Right. But so I was actually specifically, that is very good. That's a good information that I was not aware of. But I was specifically referring to something that will be, you know, for the protection for your income. So let's say you become disabled and you're not able to work. So the insurance policy will pay for the disability. But from the employer point of view, you can still buy the long-term disability, which will cover your 66% of your annual income, your income. So would you recommend investing in the long-term disability insurance?
Yeah, you can, depending upon the cost versus benefit. So there are two scenarios. So in young age, the probability of having long-term disability is through accident. Majority cases, like major probability. And in accident, the auto insurance policy comes into picture. So depending upon the severity of your injuries and the medical things, you will get covered by that. So you just have to see like how much it is costing. If it is comes cheap, then definitely you can go for it and have a peace of mind. But if it, and I hope that it won't cost that much. And especially if it is through employer, it will cost even less. So if that concerns you, then definitely you can go for it and have a peace of mind.
Yes, Prabhuji, thank you. Yeah, it doesn't cost much. It's like, I think $5-$10 per paycheck.
Yeah, right.
Right.
Yeah, so okay. As it is said that there is a saying that in Britain, like they said that penny wise, pound foolish. You know, so like you want to save pennies and then you spend pounds. So we should not be like that. If by spending pennies, if we have the complete peace of mind, that is a wise thing to do.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Yeah, Hare Krishna.
I think we have a lot of questions in the chat room as well. I don't know, you have time to cover.
I'm fine, Prabhuji, as long as you are fine.
I'll throw in a couple of questions, quick answers, maybe, probably.
Yeah.
We have property in India. How to bring that money back?
Again, like it's a, not a short answer, but just a few critical points I will cover. So depending upon your resident status and the citizenship status, there are complications involved in it. Both in India as well as in US. In India, you have to hire a CA to do the paperwork. And in US also, then you have to take care of declaring all this in your corresponding income tax return of that year. And there would be tax implications. So you have to make sure that you do your calculations before you do that.
Okay. What is the best plan for the child studies?
Yeah, as I said, if child is young, then as we discussed last time, that either having your own ETF investments or buying a IUL policy while the child is young, so that you have 15 plus years to build that corpus for his or her college education. So that is the best. Again, like nothing replaces systematic saving and investing. So you don't have to have 100K for college education in one shot. You have to have 100K over a period of 10, 15 years. So then it's not a problem.
Okay, thank you. question, old age after 65, Medicare will come. It's not covered full, then any other source to cover full, Prabhuji?
Yeah, so in Medicare, as I said, various options are there, Part A, Part B, Part C, Part D. So with combination of this, you get full covered. So make sure that you evaluate all the options which are available in Medicare and take advantage of those. Because with Medicare, you have supplemental coverage also. So depending upon your personal health situation, you can still get covered for all situations so that you don't have to worry about anything.
Okay. So I'll just take a little our promo break here. There might be more questions in this chat room. I would like to just inform all the devotees, the programs we run here, and just take, Prabhuji, if you are okay, can I take a 30 seconds break?
Sure, Prabhuji, definitely.
Thank you.